I think we'll get started. I'll do a brief introduction and then turn it over to you, Alon. So welcome, everybody. Thank you for joining. Just wanted to say a few words about this Zoom series. It's a series, actually. This is the second or third, and we have them planned ahead for the next few months. The topics are all topics of interest to Alon, and I think to most of you. Mostly focusing on the environment, but also next month, for example, we're talking about women's issues, and we've talked about progressive Judaism in the past. The idea of these sessions is to be an open forum. It's not supposed to be one directional, just alone speaking and everybody else listening. We'd like to hear questions, we'd like to hear comments, feedback. We've gotten some great ideas already from the Zoom sessions, and hopefully we'll get more. To that extent, we've reached out and we have some co-sponsors for this event and for future events. Our co-sponsors for this event are Aytzim, and David Krantz is here, and we thank him for his help with this Zoom call and other ones in the past and in the future. Other co-sponsors are Hillel at the University of North Carolina and the Sterling Institute for Jewish Studies in Modern Israel at Michigan State University. And we're looking to expand that and include more co-sponsors for future events. So thank you to our co-sponsors. And in the spirit also of having a conversation and not just a one-way lecture, we have three other speakers and three other people who will be talking today. Those are Munqeth, who's the former chair of and Jordanian board member for EcoPeace Middle East. Also, Dr. Tareq Abuhamed will be joining us later. He's the director of the Arava Institute. And also with us today is Ayelet Rozen, who's head of multilateral environmental agreements at the Israel Ministry of Environmental Protection. We've already received some questions via email. Feel free to write questions in the chat. At the end, we'll leave ample time for people to ask questions. Just raise your hand and we'll get to you. And I think that's it. Oh, also, there's a user called Newsletter here in the chat. If you would like to sign up for Alon's newsletter, please feel free to message me your email address or to the newsletter, and we'll make sure to add you to that. And I think that's it. Alon, the floor is yours.
Good evening to one and all, and welcome to my friend Munqeth, who I've not seen in a while, and it does me, my mood picks me up completely to see you smiling there, and Ayelet Rozen, who is coming in from great distance and effort. We appreciate your efforts, and I know that as soon as he gets something to eat, because it is Ramadan, Tareq will be joining us as well. It was a unique day on Friday. I don't remember a day when Earth Day coincided with the holiday of Passover, the second holiday. And it got me thinking about, well, what is the meaning? Obviously, this can't be a coincidence. And what does it mean that our Festival of Freedom is this festival that we try to celebrate to protect our dear Earth? And I started thinking about what it means to be a slave in the modern age. And I think we all realize to some extent, we all are in bondage, enslaved to fossil fuels and a means of production which are leading this planet to ruin. And as of late, I'm getting more and more concerned about that. And so for me, my sort of takeaway from that is that this, if we think about what it means to aspire for freedom, took a great leap of faith for children of Israel to leave the Pharaoh in Egypt and move to a freer place. We need to also make a great leap of faith and change the way we live and like it. And so before I go any further and talk a little bit about what's happening in the Knesset, I will make a quick recommendation. I decided that you'll hear in a second that we're going to be having the first hearings in Israel's proposed climate law. And I thought I needed to start sort of revive some of my basic understanding and knowledge. So I've got a bunch of books. And I want to recommend the first one. I picked it up yesterday, and it's been a long time. We talk about inhaling a book. This is a book I started in the morning and finished in the evening. It's called The Story of More, How We Got to Climate Change and Where to Go From Here by Hope Jaron. I'd read her first book, which is called Lab Girl, was a big bestseller. She's a brilliant scientist, fantastic writer. It's very engaging. And I've read a lot of books about climate change. I learned a lot from her. And in the next one, I can report to you in the next one that I'll be reading about, All We Can Save, which is a compilation of articles, which was a New York Times bestseller, Truth, Courage, and Solutions for the Climate Crisis. And the reason why that's important is because, like I said, the government should be voting perhaps next Sunday, the week after, whether or not they want to approve a climate law for Israel. Part of this government's platform was to adopt a climate law, but there's very big discrepancies about what different ministries believe should be in a climate law. And so the law that was proposed by the Ministry of Environment was watered down in a most unfortunate way. And my committee, I chair the committee, a subcommittee for environment, climate, and health in the Knesset. And we'll be having the first hearing to discuss this and hopefully hold the bureaucrats, the Ministry of Finance's feet to the fire a little bit and see why it is that they were so anemic in their objectives for a law which is so important for the to save the country. We in the Middle East, who are a hot spot, and I'm sure that Munqeth will have plenty to say about that, because Jordan is certainly suffering at least as much as Israel, if not more, from the climate change, should be more and more sensitive. So that's something we've got up right now. Israel's Knesset, our parliament, is in recess. It started a few weeks ago with the Purim holiday, but when we finish our Independence Day celebration 2 weeks from now, we'll be back in session again. It's a time of political turbulence. It's not clear what it means, but my wonderful staff, which you can see on the screen, maybe you can all wave if you're from my staff. Teddy, you can wave too, because he's running everything that we're doing in terms of our English-speaking world. We just had a meeting about how we can take what seems to be a hard, dark time for our coalition and leverage it into an advantage for environment. In the past, our laws have been some of the few laws which received the support of the opposition. Yes, even Likud was in favor of, our law to expand the class action suit to allow environmental organizations to join. And that's because the former Minister of Environment, Gila Gamliel, is a co-sponsor. So we've reached across the aisle, and hopefully as Israel reaches goes through the session with a tenuous majority for the government, we'll still be able to move forward on our legislative initiatives. We also look forward to working on the coastal revision law, which would cancel all about 22 development programs designed to really cross that 300-meter line and gobble up really valuable coastal areas. And I think that's one of the laws that we're going to be focusing on as well. One of the laws that we probably won't be able to move forward to, although it would be wonderful, we is a basic law. Israel doesn't have a constitution. We have basic laws like England. And as such, we try to put constitutional provisions in that there's no constitutional protection in Israel for the environment, although a lot of other rights are protected, like workers' rights. And one wonders what will happen when workers' rights go against the environment. Will the environment always lose? So you want to have some sort of symmetry there. And Sneer, who's shaking his head, who's been the biggest advocate within our office, even though this is very ambitious, sort of punching above our weight, but we did submit a constitutional provision, and we're very hopeful that, who knows, but you need 61 votes to pass a basic law, so it may not be in the cards for this session, but you never know. Israeli politics is unpredictable. So we have other laws involving the phasing out of wood stoves, which turn out to produce about a third of the hazardous air pollutants during the winter months. And we have a lot of legislation that is potentially on the docket, and we can't wait to get started in 2 weeks. But that's not what today's talk is about. Today's talk is about a subject which is particularly important for me historically, and that is transboundary environmental opportunities. It is no secret that 10 years of rule by Bibi Netanyahu's government did not bode well for Israel's relationship with its neighbors. And we know that a level of trust that I think at some point was quite healthy with the Hashemite Kingdom of Jordan was really lost. And many potential opportunities for working together really were lost with them in terms of the environment. And that's a great, also with the pension of the previous government to sort of weaken moderate government of President Abbas is now something which has also, I think, held us back. But with this new government of change, I'm hopeful that the circumstances are different now. And we all know that Israel is no bigger than a postage stamp ecologically. And if we don't work with our neighbors on many issues, we aren't going to make progress. And so that's why I think many of us were so very excited in November when in Dubai, the agreement was signed, which actually I think culminated, you'll get the full history from Munqeth because he was the chair when things got started, the so-called the water energy nexus. And for the first time, we have a real agreement between Israel and Jordan, which would take advantage of Jordan's potential for being a really robust solar generator and Israel's advantages in terms of being on the Mediterranean Sea and having the world's best desalination technology. Jordan needs a lot more water. Israel needs a lot more clean energy. Doesn't it make sense to work together? And for the first time, this agreement, which was signed tri-party, I think it's going to be, if I remember the details, $160 million, which our good friends at the United Arab Emirates are going to bankroll. I think they'll split the proceeds with Jordan to produce, if I'm not mistaken, 600 megawatts of electricity. And Israel in return will send over 200 million cubic meters, which for you Americans out there might be something like 200 billion quarts of water. That's a lot of water, and hopefully that will ameliorate some of the acute shortages that they have in Jordan. So that was a very exciting moment when all these years, when organizations like EcoPeace Middle East primarily have been promoting this vision, and everybody thought that they were just a bunch of dreamers. And lo and behold, the day of the dreamers came, and there was a plan on the table, and it got approved. And I'm very honored to have been a member of that board for many years, and it was a really, I think, an exciting moment. But I often like to feel like the Abraham Accords, to some extent, brought to an end the so-called Israel-Arab conflict. In other words, all this notion that the entire Arab world is, united in its desire to destroy Israel just doesn't hold up to reality anymore when countries like Morocco and Sudan and Bahrain are on board, and who knows who will join next. That doesn't mean we don't have a very serious dispute with the Palestinians, one that is festering that we need to address. And I know that my staff has been working with me and with the people in the Defense Department to try to put together some concrete packages. Although the Defense Minister Gantz, who's the chairman of the Blue and White Party, of which I'm a member, has made, I think, some significant stride forward to try to improve the quality of life for Palestinians in terms of their economic conditions, but maybe not yet made some progress with the environment. But I think they come together. And there's three areas that we're looking on focusing on. These are things that we've been talking about for years. Of course, one is producing solar energy in Area C. The Palestinians import 90% of their electricity from Israel, and Israel can't produce enough electricity for itself. And we're thinking of making gas power plants and creating all kinds of problems. If we could give the Palestinians a little more autonomy in the energy area, they would be healthier. Israeli energy system would be better off, and everybody would be a winner. And of course, Jordan's ability, Jordan does export a small amount of electricity into Jericho, but wouldn't it be nice if they could export a lot more? So that's one issue that we'll talk about. The sewage treatment in the West Bank remains unacceptable, very, very poor. It pollutes the streams. It creates all kinds of nuisances and hazards for the Palestinians and for the Israelis. Sometimes it's a problem of not having the funds to maintain it. Sometimes it's a problem of not having a solution at the end. So you have a situation in Nablus where the sewage is treated, but nobody wants to take it in the end. So they pour it back into the stream, which the Zomar flows into the Alexander stream and picks up more waste along the way. By the time it comes into Israel, it's polluted again. And the Palestinians end up paying twice, once in Nablus to fix it and once at the Israeli border. This is just lunacy. So we have to find ways to do better there. And of course, the Palestinians need more water. And of course, for the first time, I'm delighted to say after 11 years of absence, the Joint Water Committee has reconvened and starting to talk again. And this is important as we try to move forward and reach really a better way of living together with our Palestinian neighbors. So I said I'd talk 15 minutes to get it started. I know that my dear friend Munqeth has things to do yet tonight, and I want to give him the chance to speak. Teddy, do you want to introduce him, or should I embarrass him by saying really nice things about him? What would be the best?
You can, I think you should go ahead.
Well, Munqeth, first of all, he's a pilot. And he's not only a pilot, but he's a diver. I first met him when he was head of the Jordanian Royal Diving Society, a proud graduate, an engineer from Virginia Tech. He's had many different careers, all successful. But most of all, I think he'll go down in history as the personality who really allowed this organization, EcoPeace Middle East, to flourish and become a major force and ultimately engineer this remarkable agreement. And I'm proud to call him a friend. And I'm so glad you could find time to be with us tonight and share some of your feelings about where we stand now, how well we're doing in the region, what needs to change. Munqeth, the floor is yours. How are you? Are you with us?
I'm really proud of and happy and glad of knowing you all through the years and calling you a good friend. In fact, we always came back to you for advice, and we found it. In fact, and you have your share of making this organization flourish and survive very, very bad times. And if we remember. Thank you very much for the introduction, and you almost said it all, Alon, since you are really, really involved. But Yanni, a bit I picked up from your speech in the beginning when you were talking about the law, trying to push the law in the Knesset, and trying to convince other ministries that the environment ministry is trying to push this law, but you need to convince them. It's the same thing we have in Jordan. You know, like it's really strange when you go to a even water ministry and try to convince the people there that there is something called climate change and we need to address it. It puzzles me that people still deny it or they don't know much about it. Okay, especially in Jordan. Jordan is really suffering from climate change. The rain pattern is completely changed from what we know and we used to. Our dams is dry. Anytime a good rainfall, it fills up a bit, but very, very quickly we use it. And here we go, we are facing a crisis. Jordan is really trying hard to compensate for all these water deficits we have in the country. But it's a one project is never enough. I remember also, and Alon, you've been in this fight also when we were talking about the Red Dead Canal, how people really thought that their problems would be solved with the Red Dead Canal. And we tried to convince them that this is not a viable, a good project for the environment, and it has a lot of consequences. But they were completely blinded by the idea of, like this book behind you, the other book, Teddy, is Let There Be Water. You know, I wish we can have somebody that says, let there be water, and water will come along. But it does not work that way, of course. So what you really said and started with, Alon, is that the regional cooperation is a must. I wish you can share with us that law you're trying to pass in the Knesset so we can really show it to parliamentarians here and try to push something similar. Because if Israel or Palestine work by themselves on the other side of the river without Jordan, it's as if you're doing absolutely nothing. A world heritage, a very, very important shared ecosystem like the Jordan River needs everybody to work on it, not only one side or two sides. The lost side will be doing more damages than whatever you're trying to fix, in fact. So then we come out with the conclusion that a regional cooperation is a must. Now, there is also other fruits, low-hanging fruits, that you can pick up really quickly. And at the same time, gain trust. As we see, trust is the problem of this region. People, or especially politicians, not you alone, but they have a problem with trust. Okay. And here we are. We have a project, which is the Water Energy Nexus. It's the latest one. In fact, we had so many other projects in EcoPeace that succeeded and we're a bridge to bring people together. But the Water Energy Nexus, like Alon explained to everybody, it will really be a win-win for all sides, both sides, and also the Palestinians. Jordan needs the water. Jordan has about 600 million cubic meters of water deficit every year. Those 200 will make a big difference, the 200 million coming. Jordan has a vast land in the east, the desert, which it lost its value with the climate change. A lot of rain, we lost a lot of rain in the eastern desert. So the grazing fields that used to be good for grazing for so many tribes in the east, it's not flourish anymore. They can hardly find a grazing area. So it's a vast land with a lot of excellent solar radiation, but low value. And that land can produce enough energy for the whole region. I'm talking about Iraq, Syria, Palestine, Israel, and even a bit for Saudi Arabia. So it's really a blessing for Jordan to have such a location. One question, why should the Jordanian desert be any different from the Saudi Arabia or in Iraq? That's the way it is. It's the location, the proximity from water, big mass of water like seas, Mediterranean, and so on. It's very dry. The sunrise comes directly. It's the elevation. So a meter square can produce 30% more solar power than anywhere else. So if we can really invest in all these criterias, Israel being the best technology ever in the world for desalination, and if we can put all this together and move on in a project that can really be a model for even bigger and bigger projects. And that's what we've been working on. And finally, thank God that we've been working on this water energy nexus for almost 10 years now. And here we are. We are opening doors, and inshallah, and very soon it will work. Now, you also addressed something very, very important, Alon, is that the relationship with other countries, okay, like Arab countries, like the UAE and the Bahrain and Morocco. Well, Yani, if you listen to people, a lot of people are really, really angry from this relationship because they feel that the Palestinian problem is behind them, behind Israel. They are not thinking about it. They're thinking of going away, you know, to the Arab world. But you mentioned something that really drew my attention and made me think that this kind of relationship, now the Israelis can see that the Arabs is not that they want to throw Israel and the Jews into the Mediterranean. There is a mistrust that was not in its place from the beginning. So when we have a Arab states that approaching a peace process and helping Israel to approach a peace agreement with the Palestinians and end the occupation and give those people their sovereignty, I think we can really move in much, much faster and bigger way. I seriously wish that the Palestinians will have their state and their sovereignty so we can really, really work much, much better.
Teddy, maybe before Munqeth leaves, there may be some specific questions for him, and then Ayelet can go on. But I understand you have to leave. Are you going to be with us for a while more? How long will they have for questions for you, Munqeth?
I can make another 10 minutes, maybe.
Okay, so because I saw that there was a question in the chat from Angela Godfrey.
Yes, I'll just read it out for everybody. And yeah, I think it would be best if Munqeth could answer it. Is it possible to start organizing a delegation, perhaps starting with some people present on this Zoom, and messaging and mission to COP27 in Sharm el-Sheikh? Munqeth, is it possible to organize a delegation from Jordan that will be coordinated? Is EcoPeace already organizing?
I did not get the question really well.
I think she wants to know is, you know, the next, every year we have a big UN convention for the climate, We had Glasgow this year, and next year it's going to be in Sharm el Sheikh. It's going to be in the region locally. And I guess they want to know what are you thinking about that conference? What the potential? What's Jordan's climate policy in general? What is EcoPeace thinking as a potential there? I'll reframe it that way.
Well, a lot of good things can come out of these conferences, really. And the more we put people together to discuss, you know, problems and to discuss solutions, it's really, really good. EcoPeace will definitely have a role to play, especially with the Jordanians now started to accept the idea that, okay, I will be dealing with Israel across the border to send renewable energy across the border and receive water from there. So I think it'll be a huge, big advantage for us to be there and to lobby the government that they'll be attending that conference also.
There is another question that came in on Facebook, actually, that's about Jordan. The question is about placing wastewater treatment plants in Jordan and using that water for agriculture, which Munqeth, you spoke about earlier, and then using that water again to refill the Dead Sea. Is that something that's being considered or done?
Absolutely. If you go back to our plans in the rehabilitation of Jordan River and also the development of the Jordan Valley, we talk a lot about this sewage water or to treat the water that we use. Unfortunately, in Jordan, it's only about 16% of the water, of the total water used, is being treated. As you know, collecting the water and treating it takes a lot of money, and it needs really a good support. And that's what Jordan is lacking. But we address this. We know that Jordan can reuse the water and contribute to the Jordan River. In fact, when we did our study in the rehabilitation of the Jordan, we found out that Jordan should bring back about 90 million cubic meters of water back to the Jordan. And our studies showed that Jordan can do that from the water treatment plants, that you can treat the water and put it back in the Jordan River. And even some of it can go to the agriculture, like you're saying. But if you think of it today, there is about 600,000 people living in the Jordan Valley, and there is only two small water treatment plants, one in the north, which it's newly built by the USA, and one in the middle by the Arava, which is very small and cannot handle any whatever they bring it. And both water treatment plants, the water comes by trucks, not by network. So it needs a big investment, a huge big investment. And I think EcoPeace was willing to help the Jordanians to try to raise some money for that.
Okay. I think if we're going to stay on schedule, maybe we should invite Ayelet to step up and speak now. I want to express my gratitude to Ayelet Rozen, who has been a longtime advocate of environmental interests on behalf of Israel in the international realm. She heads the international division there and has been involved, I think, with every major environmental convention for the past decade. So she's a walking institutional memory and has not lost a bit of her commitment over the years, and an ally, I think, for all the environmental groups over the years have always tried to be engaged in international conventions, and they always knew that they could count on support, not always from the minister, but they could certainly get it from the minister's staff. And thank you so much for finding the time for being with us. Ayelet, maybe you can talk a little bit about the Ministry of Environments in general. We're talking about climate change and in general, its attitude towards cooperation with its neighbors.
Great, thank you. Can you hear me? I just want to be sure I've unmuted myself successfully. Great. Okay, so thank you very much for inviting me to be to speak with this group here. Any contact is always really welcome. And just from hearing things that Munqeth was saying, I was thinking of all sorts of ways that we can try and promote a cooperation further. So I think everyone recognizes that we're at a critical juncture, both in climate change, and I'd also like to mention biodiversity, the sister convention to climate change. The interrelationship between the two is becoming increasingly apparent, and the scientific evidence for the need to remain within 1.5 degrees Celsius of increased temperature since the industrial period is so undeniable now. I mean, each report of the organization called the IPCC, which provides the scientific basis for climate change decision-making, has made it abundantly clear. This is what they call the critical decade. And this is true for biodiversity. We are losing a huge amount of biodiversity, and the understanding that that's what supports the whole system and our existence here, the ecosystem services provided, is becoming increasingly clear. And I also think the pandemic has emphasized the mutual dependency of human beings and nature. So in a way, this should be a period of recognition of the importance of what's called multilateralism, of countries coming together, making decisions in which every country agrees to take its part. Of course, we all know what the disadvantages are. Trying to get 197 countries to agree on anything means that very often the decisions reflect the lowest common denominator. And then it's up to national governments and countries themselves to be a little bit more enterprising and take it forward. So if I look at what I do in my waking hours, which is basically working on these multilateral agreements, it can either be the blah, blah, blah that Greta Thunberg refers to, or it can really be an impetus to government doing things. Now, traditionally in Israel, what's a little bit more positive than perhaps what happens in the United States is the default lines are not right and left. You perhaps there is a little bit more support for environmental things on the left wing side of the spectrum, but really not the kind of bifurcated approach we see in the United States. So that means very often that Israel has periods where more is done or less is done, not right and left, but very often as a reflection of the commitment of the minister. How much the minister wanted the job is perhaps the best point of analysis. Very often the ministry, because it was relatively weak, would be given as a consolation prize, and then the ministers were not particularly committed. What we are fortunate at the moment, and I as a public servant, of course, my job is to support any minister as they come in. But the current minister is truly committed to environmental issues. She comes from the NGO sector, and she wanted the job. And that's very important. And it's supported by an activist Knesset. And so this coalition, tenuous as it seems at the moment, has been a breath of fresh air. We've been functioning for 2 years without a budget, and that has brought everything to a kind of a state where not a lot was done and there wasn't much vision. Individual events were happening and individual initiatives went forward, but there is really a feeling that however vulnerable the government is now, we've got a window of opportunity to push things forward. And of course, the main thing is what Alon mentioned, and that's the climate law. The climate law was supposed to come up a few weeks ago, and it was deferred because there was so much else on the Israeli agenda. And of course, that is traditionally the challenge. So many other things take precedence. How do we create the conditions so that something like the climate change legislation, even though it has definitely been neutered from the draft that we prepared within the ministry, how can it get the minimum level of political support needed to take it forward? How can we be one of the few remaining developed countries that don't have a climate law on the books? But in addition to that, as Alon mentioned, this coalition government put climate change as one of the founding guideline principles of the coalition government. We have the budget, And the vulnerability of the coalition adds this sense of urgency to what is being done. So there's the climate bill. We passed the tax on single-use plastic, which has led to a 50% reduction in the use of single-use plastic since the law came in, which is a very, very gratifying result. Particularly over Pesach, there was a huge public awareness campaign. There are large sectors of the population who have traditionally used single-use plastic, particularly large families. And a lot of the public awareness campaign was focused on persuading them that we have to wean ourselves over this dependence on single-use plastic. The deposit of all plastic bottles came in. There's a new strategic plan for biodiversity that's supposed to be prepared by the end of the year. There's new funding for electric vehicle infrastructure. But in the end, our commitment to climate change, while it is a vast improvement on the previous commitment given in 2015, still in comparison to other developing countries, is very low, which is why a central component that we wanted to put in the climate law was the legislative commitment to a certain level of reduction of greenhouse gases. And this is what is fearful to the various sectors in the government. Committing, making statements in Glasgow is one thing. Actually committing yourself in legislation to various standards is a little bit more difficult. And the reason, of course, that it's so important and why regional cooperation, for all the reasons that were mentioned before, is so important, is that the Middle East is a hotspot. The Middle East is vulnerable. The Middle East needs to increase its level of resilience to climate change. A lot more emphasis needs to be put on the question of adaptation to climate change. It's not only are temperatures rising more in the Middle East than elsewhere, but sea levels are rising around our rim of the Mediterranean. And of course, Israel is on the border between, it's the closest European, if you know, to the extent that you consider it European, to Africa, which means that climate refugees, mass migrations, which were anticipated, will affect Israel as it begins to then move northwards. So Israel, which traditionally has perhaps said, you know, small country, limited greenhouse gas emissions, what role do we play, actually plays a pivotal role and plays a pivotal role in the solutions because of our climatic complexity. There are species, there are solutions. Because we are very often the northernmost point or the southernmost point for a species. So we represent adaptation to climate change as a natural laboratory. So we can give a lot in that sort of area. And our ministry is involved in an initiative called Desert Tech at the moment, which is to try and bring desert technologies to our neighbors, to the region. And that, of course, brings me both to the Abraham Accords and to COP27 in Egypt. Egypt has put a great deal of emphasis on this coming COP, the convention of the parties to the Climate Change Convention. It represents Africa, and therefore it wants a lot of solutions that are relevant to arid and semi-arid climates to be presented. And that's where, you know, we consider, spearheaded by the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, this is an important opportunity not to be missed, both in Egypt this year and next year in the Emirates. The focus will really be on our area, on our solutions, and what we can bring to our neighbors, and on what we can cooperate together with our neighbors, whether in mitigation or in adaptation. So for the first time, Israel will be setting up a pavilion. We've never done this. It's quite an expensive undertaking. So that for 11 days, we would really like to showcase solutions in the area, do events together with whoever is willing to do events with us. And we've contacted all sorts of organizations and governments. Israel traditionally adds to its list of delegations anyone who wants to get to this kind of meeting. And that is really not typical of other countries. We put NGOs and the business sector in order to encourage maximum participation. So, of course, one new event we have for this year is building on the Abraham Accords. And what is interesting is that the Abraham Accords enable us to bring in partners who in the past could not deal directly with Israel. So it becomes a vehicle for broader cooperation, not necessarily just with the Emirates, but with other parties who are happy to join once the Emirates are involved. And I have to say, it's really very moving for me also as a woman that our contact with the representatives, with the professional level that we deal with at the in the UAE is with highly, highly educated women, often with American accents. I presume they've undergone training in the United States, and a whole cadre of committed, educated, knowledgeable, and enthusiastic women in the main who are dealing with these issues. So we have cooperation over creating a regional PRTR, that's a registry of pollutants for the area. There's cooperation on biodiversity, cooperation on desert technologies, which is very important. And on those things, I also really have to give credit to EcoPeace and other NGOs who, in the years in which there was not governmental support for cooperation, and that happens whether with the Palestinians, the Jordanians, the groundwork done by civil society is so important in just keeping alive the contacts that then can be built on once there is the approval, the funding, and the willingness at government level. So just to end, I want to say that Israel traditionally has emphasized its role in technologies. But of course, technologies have to be suitable for the areas in our region. And that will continue to be a big focus. What we're focusing on more is the idea of tweaking technologies. Technology in Israel has often been built on military technology, which is then converted to civilian use. And very often the connection to environmental issues is less clear, but there are lots of things that can be tweaked, whether it's satellite imagery to help with creating climate change maps, which then inform policy. I cannot help but be optimistic. The challenges are great, but that I hope is pushing us to solutions. I met with a law professor at Columbia the other day, and he very proudly showed me a poster that he'd kept of an event he organized with EcoPeace on cooperation in the Middle East. This was a few years ago. So I would say all these initiatives that might seem fairly minor at the time, they all coalesce. And when the time is right, things go forward. So I would like to just end very quickly with reference to Rabbi Akiva. Rabbi Akiva, Second Temple rabbi, who we now mark the period of time where his students died of a mysterious plague. Somebody said one of the first COVID expressions. And he was completely ignorant till the age of 40. And at the age of 40, he saw a stone which had a hole made in it by the continuous dripping of water. And he said, if a stone can be worn down by a natural element like water, Akiva can become a sage starting at the age of 40. And I think that seasonal message of Rabbi Akiva is very important for all of us working in this field. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Ayelet. I see that Dr. Abuhamed has joined us, so we'll welcome him and give him a chance to say a few words. And I do want to try and save some time for questions or comments by people here also before
sure. We finish. But I'll intervene just for a minute so that I have the opportunity to give a proper introduction. If we have a reason to be optimistic, Dr. Tareq Abuhamed and the Arava Institute are certainly one of them. Dr. Abuhamed is a leading scientist in the area of solar technology. He has served as the deputy chief scientist at Israel's Ministry of Science. He is a beloved teacher for years now at the Arava Institute. And as of almost a year now, I think, he's been the director of the Arava Institute, leading it from strength to strength. And I want to thank him because unlike most of us, he didn't get to eat today, and he interrupted his breakfast dinner after to be with us. And we're so grateful that for what you're doing in the Arava Institute, and that you could find time to share with a bit of your experience on these issues of environmental cooperation in these challenging times.
Thank you, Alon. Hi, everyone. Good evening or good afternoon. It's really great pleasure to be with you. Ayelet, your presentation or your talk is a great introduction to the work that we do at the Arava Institute. Here in the Middle East, we don't lack energy resources. We have plenty of sun that can provide us with all kinds of energy that we need for electricity production, for transportation, and even for domestic use. And we have the right technologies to desalinate water. So water scarcity, energy scarcity, with the technologies that we have, it's not a big challenge today, both energy and water resources. So what do we lack here in the Middle East? We lack trust. We don't have trust in the region that we live in, and that's what prevents us from doing regional cooperation. We joined the COP26 in Glasgow, and one of the main incomes that came out of that COP is regional cooperation. International cooperation is a must. And in our region, okay, without trust, you cannot do regional
cooperation. Alon Tal.
Sorry, Ayelet?
No, sorry.
Yeah. And this is exactly what the Arava Institute is doing. We bring people together. We are an academic and research institution. Our academic program is accredited by Ben Gurion University of the Negev. One third of our students are Arabic speakers, Palestinians from both West Bank and Gaza, Jordanians, Israeli Arabs. And sometimes we have students from North Africa, from Morocco, one third Jewish Israelis, and one third international students. So these students, they live together 24/7 for 4 months. We are located in Kibbutz Sektora in the Arava. So when I say they live together, we mean it. They go to the same dining room in the kibbutz, they go to the same classroom, and at the end of the day, they go to the same dorm where they share rooms. And when we talk about regional cooperation, when we talk water rights, sources of pollution, politics always rise. So they discuss, they shout, they cry, but they have no place to go. We are in the middle of nowhere. They go back to the dorms and they learn how to live with each other. We also have several research centers on renewable energy, on transboundary water management, sustainable agriculture. We have the Center for Arid Social Ecology, and we have several programs for capacity building also in Africa and also in the region that we live in. And as the relatively new executive director, I have three main focus areas. One is to put all of these research centers under the umbrella of the climate change. Everything that we do at the Arava Institute is related to climate change. And we at the Arava Institute try to focus on transboundary environmental issues. We live in a very tiny, tiny region, and environmental cooperation is a must. The pollution doesn't matter where it originates, it impacts all of us. Most of the aquifers that we have, they are shared aquifers. The Gaza aquifer is shared between Israel and Gaza, the coastal aquifer. The mountain aquifer is shared between the West Bank and Israel. The eastern aquifer between Jordan and Israel. The Arava aquifer is shared between Jordan and Israel. So regional cooperation is a must. And this is what we try to do at the Arava Institute. We want to establish the regional climate change center. We are in Kibbutz Sektora, 30 miles from Aqaba in Jordan, 32 miles from Egypt, 40 miles from Saudi Arabia, half an hour from Tel Aviv, with flight from Natbag to the Ramon Airport. And this is my vision, this is my plan, to convert the Arava Institute to regional climate change hub. This is the photo here shows the new campus. We're extending our campus. We have capacity for 62 students. We want to grow. We want to have more impact on the region that we live in. We want to grow to 92 students, then to 150 students. The campus, the regional hub for climate change. It will have the LEED standard, the LEED gold standard. That means this building will produce its own water its energy, treat the wastewater, has hydroponics, aquaponics, and the students will live in this campus. They will use these technologies with the goal of that they will learn these technologies and copy them when they go back to their communities. My second focus is in actually the Abraham Accords, what Ayelet just mentioned. This is a great opportunity for us. We already signed a few agreements with the United Arab Emirates. We already published a few papers with different universities in Morocco. And actually, we support to have a delegation from Morocco to Israel last year, but COVID did not allow us. My third focus point is the shared society within Israel. The Arava Institute is not only a think tank, it's a do tank. And we have 25 years of experience doing projects in the ground, in the West Bank, in the Negev, even inside Gaza. And I will show you photos from that in Jordan, in Africa, in Kenya. We have this 25 years of experience, but we kind of ignored what's happening within Israel between the Arab society and the Jewish society. And I want to use that experience that we have in regional cooperation to strengthen the shared society within Israel, to recruit more Israeli Arab students to our program, to strengthen the research cooperation between the Arava Institute and the Arab research organizations in the country. What happened last April in Israel was a very powerful wake-up call for all of us. And I want to focus also on that. Some examples of projects that we have on the ground is the Track 2 Environmental Forum that we established. It's a partnership between the Arava Institute and the Palestinian organization called Damor. We do analysis of the water, food, energy, ecosystem services, including the waste, direct relationship with the community and the community leaders. Last May, during the war between Israel and Gaza, we've been in touch with our partners in Gaza. We sent three atmospheric water generator systems into Gaza Strip. This is an Israeli technology that generates water from air. We did not develop this technology. The role of the Arava Institute was to actually facilitate the connection between the Palestinian Authority and the civil administration in Israel. During the last war, we've been in touch with our Gazan partners, asking them to send us photos of the systems that we sent to Gaza. And they said it's war, the roads are blocked, we cannot reach the systems. But on Shabbat morning, the war ended on the evening of Na'erev Shabbat. And we received these photos in Saturday morning of people standing in line to fill water from these systems. This is just a technicality, but for an Israeli organization to be in touch with a partner in Gaza during the war, for me, that was a success. And on Monday, 3 days later, we received five requests from five different municipalities in Gaza, signed by the head of the municipalities. 3 days, guys, after the war, they're asking for such Israeli technology to be sent into Gaza. We managed to get the permission from the Israeli authorities, and hopefully within 2 weeks, these five systems will be inside Gaza. We also managed to send into Gaza an off-grid wastewater treatment plant. Guys, Gaza lacks of a lot of electricity. They receive 3 to 4 hours of electricity, and that prevents them from treating the wastewater. The untreated wastewater is dumped into the fields or either to the Mediterranean. When they dump it into the field, it pollutes the shared aquifer between Israel and Gaza. When they dump it into the Mediterranean, it reaches Ashkelon, which is the house for one of the largest desalination plants in the world. And because of this organic pollution, that plant had to close several times last year. So we managed to send this system into Gaza Strip. And now it's functioning. The treated wastewater will be used by a group of women to grow animal feed, and will reduce pollution, will create jobs, and will also generate water irrigation. This is another project that we do also in the West Bank. It's in Albire city near Ramallah. There is a very high quality wastewater treatment plant that treats the wastewater of Sagot, the Jewish settlement, and Albire. And the treated wastewater is just dumped into the Wadi El-Ain Valley, and it mixes with another untreated wastewater from Kalandia and Kufr Aqab, which is under the responsibility of Jerusalem municipality. And these two waters mixes, and they continue to flow into Wadi El-Kilt and into the Jordan Valley. So we managed to bring the civil administration and the Palestinian Water Authority together to agree on a route for a pipeline that will be built to take the treated wastewater from Albira, West Bank, to the Jordan Valley to help the Palestinians to use that water for irrigation. So these are just examples of projects that we conduct in the ground. These projects cannot happen without building trust, without being in touch with our partners in Palestine, Jordan, and also in projects in the Negev. The Arava Institute is planning to take part, a very active part, in COP27 in Sharm el-Sheikh. We are in touch with Ayelet, we're in touch with several international organizations, and we are planning a set of activities here in the region before COP to increase awareness both in the Arava and Eilat, and also in Aqaba. Regional cooperation is a must when it comes to environmental issues. Climate change is a global threat, but at the same time, it's a great opportunity for a country like Israel, where Israel is expert in green tech, in climate tech, in high tech, and all of these technologies will help us and will help the world to cope with the climate change mitigation and adaptation. I'll stop here, and if you have any questions, I'm more than happy to answer. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Abuhamed. We have only a few minutes left. If there are any burning questions, I'm really glad.
I think we should take a few questions because there's a lot of materials. If people have questions, we can maybe go over 5-10 minutes. Wouldn't be so bad.
Okay, so if there's any questions, you can raise your hand. We'll unmute you. In the meantime, there were some questions that came in on the sign-up form. A couple of people asked about climate emissions from the military. I don't know, Alon, if you want to answer that or one of the other speakers.
Sure. Look, there's no question that not only the Israeli military, all the military forces in the area are a major source of potential pollutants and often very real pollution. For the last, I would say, 20 years, there has been a fairly active effort in the Israeli army to regulate itself. And I'm delighted that on my staff, my chief of staff is Sneer Schwartz. You can wave to everybody, Sneer. Sneer was in charge of the environment for the Navy up until quite recently, until he decided to take off his uniform for a little bit and leave the security challenges to deal with the political challenges of the country. And we're very grateful that he has. But one of the things that I feel that we have the potential in this particular Knesset is to work with a minister of defense who actually cares deeply about the environment. And we hope early on in his tenure with this government, we worked with Benny Gantz to enunciate a policy that says that the Israeli army, which has control of enormous amounts of land in areas that are not training, physical training grounds, any of that area's potential solar generation. And there's no reason why we should be bringing on fossil fuel electricity into Israeli military bases when they could be what they call prosumers, producing their own electricity from solar. We have problems with transmission in Israel. It's a long road and we need to increase our capacity, but certainly in terms of within the bases, we should be doing that. And there's a green light, and I hope the next week or two, we're going to have a trip with my staff to see how that initiative is progressing. But the Israeli military obviously can always do more, and it's always a challenge because soldiers change and you always have to work with it. But I think institutionally there is a commitment. And like I said earlier, that when we met with the civil authority, I was delighted to see the level of sophistication and the real commitment on their part to do better to help to create a different reality for the Palestinians, where the Palestinian environmental quality can be much better than it is. And Israel and the Israeli army need to be making a much bigger contribution to that effort. If there's no other major questions, maybe we'll end.
Alon, there is a question from Ellie.
Hi, thank you, Eli. Thank you very much for the talks. It's a pleasure to see you all, and Tareq, great to see you. So my question is about the use of Article 6. So quite a few times throughout the webinar, there have been references to cross-border projects, to the difficulty of meeting Israel's very ambitious nationally determined contributions, and also to collaboration with our neighbors, so between Israel and Jordan, or the Palestinian Authority, or the UAE. And I wonder if either Tareq or Alon from the Israeli, Palestinian or Jordanian side, you could comment on any plans to use Article 6 to generate credits for Israel investing in projects abroad, and if that could be used to meet our nationally determined contributions.
I'm happy to do it unless you want to say a word to Tareq. Okay, so look, this is an issue I desperately, before I was a member of Parliament, I was on the international board of the JNF and worked very much with forestry. And I was always very, very cautious. In fact, I wrote an academic article called Carbon Cautious about using at least tree planting to those times it was the, under the Kyoto Accord, there was much more clear ability, or there was a framework for trading. There's a great risk that when you create credits or invest elsewhere, you let yourself off the hook. And Israel has been very, very good at taking the path of least resistance in all of its, I would say it's, you know, greenhouse gas generating activities. I would like to see Israel face up to the fact that our economy needs to change and needs to change fast. The way we produce electricity is destroying the planet. The technologies are getting better all the time, but what's not getting better is the political will. And so I think the fact that this government for the first time made a commitment that by 2050, Israel will be carbon neutral. And now hopefully we'll be able to pass a climate law, which will have more ambitious 2030 interim targets than we have. I would like to see us start by, instead of thinking about going elsewhere, really changing the way we do transportation in this country, the way we bury our trash. When we manufacture cement, the cement plant in Rabban produces 6% of all of our greenhouse gases. There's a lot of areas where Israel could do much, much better. And I think up until now, there was just never the, nobody's holding the emitters' feet to the fire. And I think that Ayelet is a consummate diplomat, so she was very polite about it. But I think that we haven't had a minister in the position who was really passionate about climate change until the present minister, Tami Zandberg, came on board, and she is passionate about it. And so we have to provide, I think, start with a climate law that pushes us to do more internally before we invest elsewhere. That would be my own read on this issue.
Hi, could I just add something very, very quickly about this point? As I mentioned, well, we at the ministry, we even think that the goal we've put into the draft climate law should have been more ambitious than it was, but government ministries have to compromise in order to get to
we will do our part to bring it back to where it should be.
That's great. So then when the argument was, look, there has to be a let out that if for some reason conditions change and we don't even manage to reach that, there has to be flexibility. And that was one of our suggestions, was that if we get to an extreme case where it looks like we're really not going to be able to reach that goal, then perhaps we could activate an offset under Article 6. Now, there are developed countries that have submitted a conditional, an unconditional goal. You take New Zealand, for example, that will use Article 6 offsets, but it's in order to increase massively the baseline of their basic commitment for domestic reduction. And when Article 6 is used in that way, that you're committed to your domestic reduction, if for some reason you want to increase it, then look at using offsets. So that was what we suggested to the Ministry of Finance as an option. We didn't get very far with that suggestion. So I agree absolutely with Alon that what we've got to be careful about is using Article 6 and offsets to move away from what's called environmental integrity and real reductions. It should not suffer from all the disadvantages that the previous system did, where there were not good quality offsets, and it didn't really help to reach the global goal. Thanks.
Teddy, I don't want to hold this wonderful crowd hostage. I think we should bring it to a close. I'm going to first of all start by thanking Aytzim and David Krantz, who have been very, very helpful in facilitating and providing some of the infrastructure and cybersecurity experience. So I'm very delighted we made it through the whole event without being sabotaged even once. So three cheers for that. That's twice in a row now. And also mention that if you are not already a Facebook friend or on Instagram with us, please do so. If you want to sign up for the newsletter, send us a message, and we will continue to gather periodically. There's a topic you want us to talk about, you should feel free. And most of all, for those of you who are in Israel, come visit us in Jerusalem. For those people out of Israel, come visit us in Jerusalem. And wishing all of us, it's a somber week in Israel because we're looking at the Holocaust Memorial, but let's hope, pray for peace in the Ukraine and pray for peace in the Middle East. Thank you very, very much for coming. Teddy, any?
Yeah, David, did you want to say one last word? Thank you for your help also, David.
Oh, yeah, thanks all. Yeah, I just want to say when Alon Tal got together with a bunch of others about more than 20 years ago to found Aytzim Ecological Judaism, it was all, with the idea that, we could be as an organization and as people, right? We could be pro-peace, we could be pro-Israel, we could be pro-Jews, we could be pro-Palestinian, pro-Israel's neighbors, pro the environment, pro-earth, pro-people, and that none of these things contradicted each other. Actually, to do all these things, it required to be all these things, all at once. And we've learned today, about some of the very good work that's been done to advance these issues. And we know that there's a lot more work that needs to be done. And so we're very grateful to have Alon Tal in Knesset to help really advance these issues of sustainability and of peace and environmental issues and addressing climate, advance all that going forward. Join us, in the coming months for more sessions and RSVP at aytzim.org/RSVP. Thank you all so much for joining today. Let's keep this all going.
So long. Take care.